Hi, welcome to Grace for Today. As always, if you are enjoying this, if you watch it, if you know somebody in your world who needs to know a little more about God's goodness, then for goodness sake, share this. If you're on Facebook, like it, share it, stick it on your timeline. If you haven't subscribed to our YouTube channel, look, we would love to really build that out. And so the only way we can do that is if you sign up. And so what you do, if you go on to YouTube Exchange Church Belfast, subscribe, ding the bell for notifications, and that would really help us out as a church. So are you ready to be encouraged this morning? We're going to talk about testing everything that we hear with God's word. And the scripture today that we're going to read says this: do not despise, it says in 1 Thessalonians 5:20, do not despise prophecy. Test all things. This is really important. Hold fast to what is good. So test all things, but hold fast to what is good. I want to really encourage you, and this is a really important one. It's part of actually growing up in faith and growing up in grace, is to test everything that you hear against God's word. I grew up in a kind of a situation in faith where there were lots of people who were having words all over the place. And I absolutely believe that God speaks in words of knowledge and words of wisdom. And we believe in the gifts of the Spirit. They're gifts of grace, actually. And I absolutely believe that. But I also know that being failed and being human, that we can also, you know, sometimes get it badly wrong, and there would be words from the Lord which were absolutely nothing to do with the Lord. And you know, that's not new. That happens, actually. That's happened since way back in Old Testament time. So don't be, you know, if you think I'm being hard on people today, remember even on Sunday I was talking about how Jonah, you know, prophesied to Jeroboam II, who was a terrible king, that God was going to favor him, and the Lord has to send Amos to go, no, I'm really not going to favor you, let me reverse that one up. So us being human, we're not perfect, we get it wrong. So I am really keen, and I always say to people, number one, read the Bible for yourself and understand it today. Right, so let me challenge you again around the amount of time that you spend filling your head with everything and everyone else instead of reading the Word of God. And also what I would say is, instead of just simply swallowing anything that you get, even through Christian media, and I'm including myself here, all right? You know, you have to simply go, now I can encourage you today. My job is to point you to the Word, but I am no replacement for you reading the Word for yourself, understanding the Word, and letting the Spirit of the Lord guide you in all truth. That's how we grow up. So what I would say is this: be wise and don't just swallow everything, kind of like hook, line, and sinker. You have to learn to be discerning, so that when we hear something that doesn't sit well in our spirits, such as when somebody, you know, the big one that I have had many, I'm going to say battles with, and I don't, battles with in terms of accusation and finger pointing, is the whole thing of sickness. You know, and people still today saying that God will give you sickness if he wants to teach you a lesson. You know, God uses sickness to chastise his people and to bring them into line. Now let me just ask you the question: how do you think that lines up, as an example, with the new covenant of God's unmerited favor? Are there new covenant scriptures to back up that kind of thinking? If you can find them, all right, please let me know. Send me an email or comment today where Jesus went and made somebody sick. All right, help me to understand that, because, you know, I can't see it, all right? And if you can see it, brilliant. In the new covenant, in the work of Jesus, and after the work of Jesus, where the Lord actually, you know, penalized someone with a sickness because that was the right thing for him to do. It's not actually there. So to understand the Bible, we have to read everything in its context. Now, I'm going to say the answer is obvious. Whenever you have that kind of thinking, and as soon as you align it with Jesus and what he has done for you in the cross, it's completely obvious. Why would God, who loves you, give you sickness when Jesus went to the cross and has already taken every sickness and every disease upon his own body? Why would he do it? With full assurance in your heart, then, that sickness is not from God, because it doesn't line up with the new covenant of God's grace and the work of Christ, then you can have faith to be healed. That's the point. But what assurance can you have if you believe the lie that the condition is from God? How could you go to God to pray, right, for it to be healed if it's coming from God in the first place? I used to have this conversation with people who would say, well, we pray for the sick, but we don't know whether God's going to heal them. And I would say, well, what if God sent the sickness in the first place, why would you then pray against what God's doing in their life? That doesn't make any sense. So you have to, you can't live in between. It's not even a logical position, never mind a faith position. So now, instead of thinking that God is against you, right? And because he sent sickness, what will happen is when you align that kind of thinking with the new covenant revelation of Jesus and his grace, what you realize is that every time God's on your side. So what then? Our confidence is restored, faith is renewed. And when confidence is restored and faith is renewed, then healing starts to flow like unabated through every tissue and organ in your body, through your mind, bringing peace. There's a guy called Miles Coverdale that Pastor Prince talks about. And he speaks in kind of old language, but let me just read you here what Miles Coverdale said. It said, "It shall greatly help thee to understand scripture. If thou mark not only what is spoken," so if you notice, not what is spoken or written, "but of whom and unto whom," so who's it talk about? Who was it written to? With what words, at what time, where, and to what intent, with what circumstance? Considering what goes before and what comes after. So what does that mean in real language for you on this day? I mean, essentially what he's trying to say is that if you really want to understand the Bible, you have to read everything in its proper context. That's a brilliant advice. And that came from the man who produced the first English Bible, actually way back in the 16th century. So learning to rightly divide the covenant whenever you read the Bible and doing that well means that you will always grow in confidence and in faith about Jesus. Because now that, you know, if you've received Jesus into your life today, you're under that covenant, right? You're in the new covenant. And, you know, in that new covenant, you have the right to enjoy Jesus' unmerited favor in your life every day. Isn't that incredible? So let me encourage you today, line up whatever you're thinking, whatever you're hearing, line it up. Just because somebody says to you, "Oh, the Lord said to me," that doesn't cut it. What? How does that line up with the finished work of Jesus today? How do your feelings line up with the new covenant of Jesus today? How does your fear about tomorrow line up with the new covenant teaching of Jesus today? Because the Lord will lead you into peace. He will lead you into love. He will lead you, by still waters. He'll help you to lie down so that you can receive all of his goodness promised to you under grace. So make sure you test it today. Just, you know, don't be like a child taking everything in, but instead say, "Lord, whatever I've heard, does it line up with what you have revealed is the new covenant of Jesus' finished work?" Amen. So let's just take our communion today. Really important to do this, and you do it in faith. Don't reduce taking communion to just, we just do that because that's what we do. It's not a ritual. It's an act of faith today. It's an act of faith to take bread and say, "Lord, I thank you that when you went to that cross, that you were hung there for me. And because your body was pierced, I can be whole. I can be healed. I can be in my body and in my mind in Jesus' name." And Father, we take the cup today and we say, "Father, thank you that your blood poured out means that I am completely righteous. Past, present, and future, every sin has been dealt with. Today, when you look at me, Lord, you see Jesus. You see him and his finished work, his perfection given to me as a gift. And so I put that on today, Lord, and I say thank you. That's my place of favor. That's my place of peace. That's my place of provision." Amen. Folks, have a wonderful day. Remember, share this out. Hit the button now, share it through, and let your world know today that they are loved by the God who gave it all for them. But remember, don't let anything in. Test it against the finished work of Jesus, and you will have a great day. Thanks so much. I'll see you tomorrow for more Grace for Today.